9 years of experience in programming. I actually started my career as a .NET developer, and then I got several opportunities to work in other programming languages like Java, JavaScript, and even now I'm working in a Ruby-based project. And a couple of months back, I was looking into this functional programming, and then I was started learning, and then I was wondering what are the real use cases for functional programming. Of course, there are a lot of use cases for functional programming, like machine learning, what else? Game development, even some of the compilers are actually written in functional language. But then one interesting use case for functional programming is front-end development. You know, most of the modern front-end frameworks, they are trying to enforce functional concepts into their framework. One common example is React.js. If you see React.js, you have some functional concepts like immutable state, pure functional components, right? But the problem is you still rely on JavaScript to write your code. Yeah, you have functional concepts enforced by the framework, but you still have to write code in JavaScript. And JavaScript is not a pure functional language. So you'll then end up writing off partial functional language code and then partial imperative code. And that's not good, right? Then I found Elm. Elm is a pure functional language, and it's not a general purpose language. It has only one purpose, to develop front-end application. So that's what we want. We got a functional language, and that helps you to write reliable front-end applications. So we are going to discuss about this new programming language called Elm. So this is our agenda. So we're going to see why Elm. We have JavaScript, then why Elm, right? So that's what we can see. And then how does Elm work? So what are the inner workings of Elm? What is the Elm architecture? Those things we can see. And then what exactly distinguishes Elm from other languages? What are the key concepts in Elm language? This is what we are going to cover today. And one thing I'm not going to focus today is the syntax. So do not worry about the syntax today, because syntax is something that you can learn as you code. So that's not I'm going to focus. Okay, let's start with why Elm? Why not JavaScript? So I work with JavaScript. Even my current project, the front end is JavaScript. I like JavaScript. There are a lot of useful features in JavaScript, right? It's flexible, it's easy to learn. But you know what? JavaScript comes with some trade-offs. It's not pure functional. As I already told you, even though some modern frameworks try to enforce functional concepts, you still write code in JavaScript, which is not pure functional, right? So you can't leverage all the powerful features of functional programming, like immutability, function purity. So those things we can't leverage, right? And JavaScript is dynamically typed. So that leads to a lot of runtime exceptions. You know what? JavaScript is one of the least opinionated language. You can write whatever you want. It doesn't care. It doesn't have a separate process called compilation, which will validate your code and it will give you error. It will never do that. And you will see a lot of surprising errors in the runtime. That will happen with JavaScript. It's unpredictable. You see those expressions? I put some sample expressions in the screen. Those are actually real. Even if you can try those expressions in the browser console, and you will be surprised by those weird results. That will definitely happen. Because JavaScript has a very poor type system. It has a very poor precision system. So this will end up a lot of unpredictable and invalid results in the runtime. So this is not the these are not just the problems. The another biggest problem is if you want to build a front-end application with JavaScript, you can't just go ahead and build the entire front-end application with JavaScript. That is not possible. Even though the language is dedicated only for building front-end applications, you can't just do that. You have to still rely on a lot of third-party libraries to build a reliable front-end application, right? For example, this is 2019. So you always wanted to build a modern front-end application, right? So you need a package management tool. There are a lot. So you have to go with either NPM or Yarn. And virtual DOM is trending, right? So you may want to have virtual DOM in your application. Then what? State management, immutability. Everything have a separate framework or separate library. And dynamically typed. JavaScript is dynamically typed. So you want to enforce typing in your application, so you still have to go for a third-party library. TypeScript, Flow. So these are the few examples. You can't just code with JavaScript to build a complete front-end application. You still have to rely on a lot of third-party libraries, and you have the pain of maintaining all those libraries. Your package.json will grow, your node modules will grow like anything. So, and then surprisingly, some package will break some existing API, and then you have to deal with that. But what if I tell you there is a programming language which has all these capabilities built in, and you don't have to depend on any third-party framework, and you have to develop your entire front-end application with that single language? So that is Elm. Elm is that powerful, and Elm is pure functional, and it is a strongly typed language. Elm has an advanced virtual DOM implementation in it. Elm has a sophisticated state management implementation in it. And Elm is not just a programming language. It is an ecosystem to develop the front-end applications. So whatever you want to build front-end applications, it is available in Elm. So now we can see how Elm works. How does it possible? How come everything is embedded into the language, right? We can look into that. So let's go back. Okay. So Elm is a pure functional language, right? So it is all about functions in Elm. So to get start with building a front-end application with Elm, you have to understand three primary functions. So this is the first function. The first function is init, which does not accept any input parameter, but it will return a state object, which could be a model. Okay, so that represents the initial state of the application. And this is the second function you need to focus on. This is view function, which accepts one input parameter, and it returns a DOM object. And that one input parameter is your current state of the application. This function is somehow similar to the render function in React. So you give the current state, and that gives the DOM object, right? But this is not just passive DOM object. It has the capability to send messages when something happens in the UI. If a user clicks on the UI, or if a user types something in the UI, this DOM object will broadcast some messages to the Elm application. We'll come to that. This is a third function. Update. So this function accepts two parameters. One is the message, and another one is the current state of the application. And the update function will return a new state for your application. So this is the function where all your business logic will go. And if you look at that, the first parameter is message, right? That message could be broadcasted by the DOM object. So for example, if a user clicks some button in the UI, the DOM object will fire a message. And then that triggers the update function. And the update function will get that message as one parameter, and the current state of the application as another parameter. And that will return the new state of the application. And this will work in a loop. Everything will run in a cycle. So now the update function returns the state, and that will again pass on to the view. And the view will again return the DOM object. And when something happens in the DOM, it will again trigger the update function, so the entire loop will continue. Does this architecture resemble anything? Does this ring a bell? Redux. Yes, Redux. So this is mostly similar to Redux, right? Look at the update function. Your reducer does the exact same thing in Redux. It gets the action and the current state of the application, and the reducer will reduce it to the new state. So, but the most interesting thing is, Redux is actually inspired by Elm architecture. So this is the quote given by the Redux author itself. He says the idea of the Redux is taken from the Flex design pattern, the unidirectional data flow. But the semantics is taken from the Elm architecture to make the framework more easy to adapt. So, okay, so now you got what is the Elm architecture. But you may have a question like, okay, we declared all these three functions. Elm language is just asking for functions. So we just declared. But who is invoking those functions, right? So someone is behind the scenes who is actually executing those functions in a proper order. So to answer the question, we need to understand How Elm actually compiles. So consider you write Elm code, you just write only Elm code, no JavaScript. And then when you compile Elm, you will get the JavaScript as though your build artifacts. And then you deploy those build artifacts into browser. And browser will run the JavaScript. Because browser only knows JavaScript. It has no idea what Elm is. So you have to compile down your Elm code to JavaScript. But if you look at there, there is one small block here. There is Elm runtime. When you compile your code will get converted into JavaScript. But along with that, Elm runtime also gets shipped to the browser. And Elm runtime will run along with your code, and that is responsible for calling all this view, update, and init function. Right? Any questions? OK, so we can look into some code now. So I have a very simple application here. This application is just to demonstrate those three functions in Elm. So if I click this button, it will just increment the counter. And then if you click the reset, it will just reset to zero. That's it. It's very simple. And okay, I'm sorry, 1 second. OK. So if you look at here, these are the three functions. So I declare the init function first. As I already told you, again, don't worry about the syntax. Don't get scared about the syntax. Since it's functional programming, the syntax might be a little weird. But OK, look at that. That's the init function, right? So it doesn't accept any parameter, and it returns a model. This is how you define a function in Elm. It is returning just a model. It doesn't accept any input parameter. And this is to represent the initial state of the application. And I want my counter to be zero. You see here, the counter is zero. So that's your initial state. And then comes the view function. That accepts one parameter, the current state of your application. This is your first input parameter. And then it returns a DOM object. So the DOM object, you represent it like HTML of message. Because I already told you that object have the capability to broadcast messages. So you need to say what type of message it is. So I'm not going deep into that. And then this is how you declare your UI. Because Elm is a pure functional language, it is all about functions. If you want to render a button in UI, you have to call a function called button. This is not like JS. So in UI, I have three things. One is to display the counter, and have two buttons. One to increment the counter, and one to reset the counter. But then if you look at the onClick, I specify what message needs to be fired when you click the first button. And then what message to be fired when you click the second button. That is clearly specified there. And then comes the update function. Update function will accept two parameters. One is message and model. The last thing that you are putting here, that is always the return type. Whatever comes before the return type will be considered as input parameters. So it accepts two parameters and then return the state of the object. It's like you get the message and state, and then it will reduce it to the new state of the application. So you have to handle the messages here. If it is increment counter, then I add one to the counter. If it is reset, I make the counter zero. That's it. So I just specify what messages needs to be fired on the clicking of that particular button. So that's what exactly happening. So that's a very simple application here. Do not worry about the syntax more. So let's go back to the presentation. Yeah, now we can jump into some key features, some key concepts that actually differentiate Elm from other languages. First thing, when I start practicing Elm, I found this very useful. Elm compiler always gives you human-readable error messages. That helps you to learn the language faster, and at the same time, you can quickly debug the code. We can look into a small example to showcase this feature. So I can declare a very simple function, and then I will make a simple issue in my code. And let's see how JavaScript gives the feedback. And at the same time, we'll try the same thing in Elm, and let's see how Elm gives the feedback. OK? So let me get into the node so that I can write some JavaScript code. So let's create a function. Let's create a very simple function, not a complex one. Let's say a function, say hello. Okay, when you pass a person object, I'm going to say hello to that person. That's it. So let's accept a person object and then return person.name. Am I right? That's simple, right? Okay. So let's invoke the function. Let's pass a person object that contains the name attribute. Let's say stu. Nice. Oh. I want to say hello. Right? Now the function returning hello Steve. That's fine. Let's make a typo in the code. I'm going to make a small typo in the code. Instead of name, let's make a typo. Now let's see. Can you guess what will happen? What will happen now? What will be the result of this code? Yeah. Hello undefined. First of all, JavaScript didn't give any error. There is no compilation. Of course, it won't give you any error. But even it didn't throw any exception at the runtime. It executes like as if there is no error in the code, right? And the problem is, these kind of issues can easily slip into production. That actually happened in my project. Okay, so because you have to write a lot of test cases to make sure these kind of issues didn't happen in production. But let's see the same scenario in Elm. When you install Elm, Elm will come with the Elm REPL, which you can use, you can play with the syntax of Elm. So I'm going to use the REPL. Let's create the same function here. Say hello. You don't have to say function. And it accepts a person object. Elm doesn't accept any brackets. You don't have to use any brackets. And you need to say equal sign before the definition of the function. So I'm going to return. You don't have to use the return keyword also. It will be like this. You have to use double plus because single plus is dedicated for integers, arithmetical operations, since Elm is strongly typed. I guess that's it. Okay, let's call the function. Same state, right? I'm sorry, something happened. Okay, that's my mistake. It's not colon again. Because of the habit of JavaScript. Okay, it's equal. So Elm runs and it gives the output as expected. It says, hello, Steve, right? Now let's make the typo in the code as we did in JavaScript. Instead of name, let's make a typo. Actually, Elm gives the error, compilation error, and very detailed error. It shows where the error exists, the line number, and it also puts some red mark. Here's where the error is there, right? And in addition to that, if you look at the hint, look at the hint. The interesting part is it says there could be a typo in your code. I work with a lot of programming languages and I never seen such a detailed error messages. This will help you to debug the code faster. Elm compiler is like your friend. It will do the conversation like with you during coding. So that's one of the very powerful features with Elm. And that helps me a lot while learning the language. And it also says another hint where you can add type annotations to the function. Since Elm is a strongly typed language, it's okay if you don't put the annotation. Like Elm has the capability to infer the data type from your code, but it's also okay to add annotations so that Elm compiler can give more readable error messages. So let's go back to the presentation. So we'll look into the another key feature of Elm, tagged unions. Does someone have really heard about this before? Tagged unions? Okay, so tagged unions are like composite data type. So what is composite data type? You create a new data type by combining some existing data types. That's called composite data types. And tagged unions is one of the composite data type. I can explain this better by giving you an example. Consider we have a bookshop and we are selling two products in bookshop. One is book and art. And this is the data model for book and art. So book has a title, author, and a price. And art has title artist and price. So now we got a new requirement, like we have to build a search page where the user can come and search for your products. And they should be able to search both book and art. So now you have to come up with the data type that should represent either book or art. So in object-oriented languages, you will immediately go for inheritance, right? You'll create a base class, and then you'll extract the common attributes from two classes, put it there, let two classes inherit the base class, done, right? That's what we do in OOPS. So our end solution will look something like this. Our store item will have a title price, so that's, those are the common attributes between these two classes. And then our book and art inherits that. This is okay. This is a solution, actually it solves the problem. But consider we have another new requirement. Now you have to introduce a new product into your bookshop. Say collectible. And the problem is collectible don't have the title attribute. Now what you'll do? You will go back to the base class and remove the title attribute and put it in the appropriate classes again. And then your store item will end up with only one attribute, price, right? That's what we do. And I don't think this is a scalable solution for this problem. What happens? Another product comes in, which doesn't have a price. You are giving that product for free. That's it. Again, you have to change your base class, right? So my personal opinion, I don't think inheritance is the correct solution for this problem. And Yale sees this problem in a very different way. So this is the problem statement, right? We need a store item data type. We need to create a data type that should represent a book or art or collectible. That's the problem statement. How Elm solves this problem? Let's see. You can create data type like this. You create a store item and you are saying this data type could be book or it could be art or it could be collectible. Look at the pipe symbol between those types. This is actually possible in Elm. And these are called tagged unions, okay? And in front-end application, this is really useful when I tried some simple projects. Like, for example, you have a API request, and you need to create a data type that should represent the response of the API request. Because the response of the API could be success with the data, or it could be an error with the error message, or it could be in progress. And you need a data type that should be able to represent all these three different states. And these tagged unions, this is really helpful in those kind of scenarios. And this is another key feature, zero runtime exceptions. Elm guarantees that it will not give you any exception in runtime. This is one of the tweet by one of the senior members in the Elm community. He says, after 2 years and 2 lakh lines of production code, they faced the first exception. And that is also because they accidentally put debug.crash into the code. Otherwise, they wouldn't face that exception. The point I'm trying to make is, Elm is a strongly typed language, and it actually guarantees it will never throw any exception in the runtime. Now you may wonder, how is this possible, right? For example, one of the most annoying runtime exception is, what is the most annoying runtime exception you face in your work? Null reference exception. I face that a lot of times, right? You call some function, you get the value, and do a lot of operations in that value, but then you commit it, it goes to production, and then that value might be null. That's it, right? This is one of the typical Java function. Is there anything wrong with the function? Actually, the Java compiler will not say any error, because syntactically, this code is perfect. It's legal. But is there anything wrong with the code? Yeah? Yes. The person could be null, right? So we call the find by ID function, and we're passing an ID, and then the return type is person, but the person could be null, and we didn't have any null check. So even in the development time, this code will pass. Luckily, it will pass. But in the production time, user will give some ID, and that ID don't exist in your database, and your application will crash. That will happen. So now you may wonder how Elm will avoid this problem, right? You have to represent nothing. In a programming language, how would you represent nothing? How would you represent empty? You have to have an option in language. Let's see how Elm handles this. Yeah, that's the possibility for null exception. So see, this is the function we are looking into. The find by ID, when you give integer, it returns the person. In Elm, if you define this function, it means that this function always returns a person object. It cannot return nothing. It cannot return empty. Right? This is what that means in Elm. But in reality, that is not possible, right? What if someone gives an ID, which is not a system database? You have to return null. You have to say nothing, right? So in Elm, we approach a different way to solve this problem. Elm have a special data type, which is called maybe. Any C-sharp developers here? No C-sharp developers, okay, fine. So there is a special data type in Elm, which is maybe, which means maybe represent a value or nothing. Just now we saw the tagged unions, right? This is one of the tagged union built in Elm. So maybe data type represent a value or nothing. So if you want your function to return a nothing value, you have to change the data type of that function. It should not be person, it should be maybe person. And then only you can return a nothing from that function. Otherwise you cannot. So now since you change the data type of the function, Elm compiler will see this and it will enforce you to handle the negative scenario. So that is the key thing. For example, so maybe data type is it's a kind of a wrapper data type. Your person object is inside the maybe data type, right? So if you want to do some operations on the person object, you have to extract the person object from the maybe and then you have to do something. Usually in Elm, we use pattern matching to extract the person object. So this is how the function will get transformed into. We use switch case to handle all the cases, and that's how we do pattern matching to extract the person object out of the maybe data type. But the point here I'm trying to make is, look at the first case, just person object. That is the positive case. You will do whatever you want to with the person object. But the second case is nothing. Elm compiler will not allow you to remove that line. If you remove the case, second case, Elm compiler will throw error. So this is how Elm is making sure you will not get any runtime exceptions. And I've read many use cases, case studies, like many companies are adopting Elm because of this one feature. Because they can build a reliable application with this, right? There are no runtime exceptions. So you don't have to write tons of test cases to validate your code. So next key feature about Elm is automatic semantic versioning. So semantic versioning, you must be familiar with semantic versioning, right? It is a version you use to represent a package, a library. So this is how it looks like. So semantic version have three different parts. The last part is, we call it as patch version. If you do a bug fix and you are sure you didn't break any existing API, then you increment the patch version. And if you add a new feature and then you don't break any existing API, you increment the minor version, right? But if you do anything, you do a bug fix or you add a new feature, but then you break any existing API, you have to increment the major version. You should increment the major version. If you don't increment the major version, your consumers will be surprised because they know what semantic version is. So they will allow their application to behave like they can increment patch version, minor version, but not the major version because they don't want to get any breaking changes, right? But you have to do this manually in other languages or frameworks. But Elm, the key thing about Elm is, consider you released a package to Elm repository. You built a package in Elm and then you published it. And then you want to do some changes or you add a new feature or fix a bug, something. And then when you try to publish the package again, Elm will actually validate your entire code. And if Elm finds any breaking changes in your code, it will not allow you to publish the package unless you increment the major version. So that is how Elm enforces the semantic versioning in your project. So your consumers will never get surprised by the breaking changes. So that is a really useful feature if you are managing some libraries and frameworks in Elm. So I think I'm done. So this is a summary. Elm has a lot of language features, but the problem with Elm is, yes, there is a very steep learning curve. Because Elm is not just another programming language or another framework. It is totally a different paradigm. So you have to understand a lot of functional concepts before you jump into learning Elm. But if you learn Elm, you can definitely build a lot of reliable applications that I'm sure about that. And incremental adoption. For example, if you want to adapt Elm your existing project, you don't have to recreate your entire project in Elm. You can incrementally adapt Elm one by one. For example, if you have a React project and you have 100 components already built, you can just change one component in Elm. Elm actually supports that. You can embed an entire Elm application in a single DOM object. So that is possible. So you can incrementally adapt Elm. And JavaScript interrupt. I actually wondered initially, there are tons of JavaScript libraries already available. How can I leverage those libraries? If I write my entire code in Elm, right? You can actually do that. So you have the option to communicate between the JavaScript environment and Elm environment. You can send message to JavaScript environment, and you can also receive message from JavaScript. You can do that two-way communication between Elm and JavaScript. So you have the option still to leverage the JavaScript libraries. So any questions? You can still use Bootstrap, because CSS is still common. Elm is not going to worry about CSS. You can still have CSS, and you also have option to import CSS into your Elm code. So that will still work. You just put the CDN URL of Bootstrap in the HTML. That's enough. And then there are several attributes available to specify the class name when you declare the UI components. So you can say column 3, column 4, container, row. So Bootstrap will still work. So the question is like, you want to get data. So maybe you want to request a HTTP request from your Elm application. That's how we get data, right? So how do we do that in Elm? Am I right?
Like I have a database, like MySQL database. I want to connect to the database and get data.
Yeah, so if you have an application in JavaScript or jQuery, you usually do AJAX calls, right? And if you use React, you use Fetch API, right? So in exactly similar way, Elm also has some built-in functionalities available, like HTTP client, where you can make HTTP requests to get the data from. So that is still possible with Elm.
OK. So we design a like application that uses data, and we use Elm to consume the data. So that's the thing that you are coming to. This question is possible to write
server-side coding? No. That's not possible. So you can do that in JavaScript using Node.js. But Elm, I already told you, it's not a general purpose language. The only purpose of the language is to build front-end applications. So you can't write any server-side code in Elm. You can't directly connect to database. You have to go through some web API to get the data from. Yeah, so what will be the bundle size of the application when you compile Elm, right? So I actually don't have a slide for that. But if you Google it or if you see search about Elm bundle size, I will tell you the Elm bundle size is the lowest size. If comparing to React and Angular, Elm will have very less amount of size in the bundle. It's just your JavaScript code and the Elm runtime, that's it. It doesn't have tons of node modules. So yeah, Elm will have a very less bundle size. The Elm runtime itself is a JavaScript file. Even though it is written in Elm. Sorry?
So when you're using, let's say, a Babel or something, when you're using React something, so you have the option to compile everything into a single file, that's in the JS file. So you can actually use the sort of bundlers like Webpack or something and combine everything into a single file. Can you do that?
Actually, yeah, that will happen in Elm, actually. So I think you confused with the block diagram. I put the runtime.js as a separate block, right? But in reality, that won't happen. So everything will be bundled into a single JS file. So your entire application and the runtime will go into bundle.js. And if you have any third-party dependencies, that will go. If you have any JavaScript third-party libraries, that will go as a vendor.js. So that is still there. So you don't get a different file for runtime.js. That will never happen.
Whatever we are using for Elm compiles, right? combine all the existing library or like still use the same library?
The libraries that you are using will be still be JavaScript library, but the question about the question is how will you handle the error, right? So we have a human readable good error messages. How will that happen if you use any external JavaScript library? Actually, when you send a message from your Elm code to JavaScript, you can't do that. Because JavaScript can accept anything, right? So Elm only have to make sure that it sends the right data to JavaScript. But when JavaScript send data to Elm, Elm will validate that. You can't send any data to Elm. If a function is accepting an integer, JavaScript can only have to send that integer. Otherwise, Elm will not accept that. So that kind of validation is there. But mostly I'm telling you, so the JavaScript interrupt is just an optional thing I'm telling you. So try to avoid many JavaScript libraries in the project when you build application with Elm. No, we don't have any projects in Elm because Elm is very new, actually. I'm telling you, even the first version is not yet released. The latest version of Elm is 0.19. So it's good. The community is very active. I've been in Slack and other things. So I can see there are daily regular conversations. I can see the community is active. But the product is not yet matured like React and Angular, right? So yeah, of course, we will adopt Elm in future. Hope the best. Okay. .js. I'm really sorry. I don't have idea about .js. Yeah, but of course there are a lot of programming languages now coming that is compiling down to JavaScript. I think Elm is one of them, and Elm has a lot of cool features. As of now, I don't see. Yeah. So you are asking if you compile Elm, will it come in single file, or you have an option to differentiate that to several files, right? I don't think now there is any option. So you don't have too much control over Elm compiler. You just execute a command called Elm make, and that will compile your entire Elm project and give you a simple bundle JS. So I don't think so that you have control over the files that will generate. I'm pretty much not sure about that. Anything else? And nobody asked about performance. How is Elm's performance when compared to React or Angular, right? I actually have a dedicated slide for that, but I don't think we have time. But yeah, Anant, can I take, okay. So Elm is claiming that Elm is most fastest library when compared to React and Angular. There are some benchmarking they created, but I'm not very much satisfied with that. So because Elm is actually comparing itself with some older version of React and Angular. So I just created a simple application. So this is a simple JavaScript application where I have two folders, one is Elm and React. So I can show you that. So I created this simple application to test how Elm runs when compared to React. So it is nothing but we have two lists right here, right? So this is actually created with React, and the right one is created with Elm. So I did actually a small DOM manipulation. Okay, so that is what we have to compare, right? Both have virtual DOM implementation. So how efficiently they implemented the virtual DOM? That's what we want to test, right? So this left side list is implemented in React, and that is implemented in Elm. So when you click this reorder button, right, it will actually take the last item in the list and it will insert in the first. That's a very simple DOM operation I did here. So when I click this run React, it will execute the same operation 100 times and will measure the time. And the same thing will happen for Elm and will measure the time. Let's see what happens. So that's actually the milliseconds. It took 1028 milliseconds. So let's run Elm now. 100 milliseconds. So that's the time taken for Elm to do the same kind of operations, and that's the time taken for React to do the same amount of operation. Don't think React is slow. React is still faster, but Elm is more fast. So this is the code. So I have a runner.js. That's a very simple JavaScript file, which will just trigger that operation 100 times, and it will measure the milliseconds that is taken to do that operation. And finally, I sum up all the time taken, and I'll display it there. So that's how I do it for React, and the same thing I do it for Elm. So, and I observe the result. Now I'm satisfied. Yes, Elm is faster. Testing, yeah. So you mean the question is about how to do UI automation testing, right? So that is still same. So it's still the same HTML DOM object. Actually, the code running behind it is also JavaScript. So that is exactly same. Only thing is Elm is a good language for developers. It is increase your developer experience, right? So you write Elm code, and then finally, anyway, it will compile down to JavaScript only. So everything will remain same. Thanks. Thank you so much.